keep someone from just getting shredded by that. So it's kind of interesting how the first pick of EHome could be the saving grace against the fifth pick of Digital Chaos. I maybe would have liked a Witch Doctor here a little bit more. That's kind of what I was thinking they would pick. I know it's maybe not the most popular pick right now, but I do think that the Voodoo Restoration would kind of help keep them up from a little bit of the sustained damage of EHome. They're not really a super bursty team currently. They're more the team that's just going to outlast you, take you down. And the Lifestealer pickup. Okay, that's pretty good against the Skywrath, but if he does get caught in a Chrono and gets destroyed by the Timbers, Timber is very strong against the Lifestealer. But we will see how this kind of goes. He does have a little bit of a potential Nyx Bomb coming out with the Nyx. The Nyx Nyx Bomb, decent delivery system. Maybe Kunkka will, maybe Lime on the Kunkka will go like a Blink Dagger so he can X marks the spot, jump in, deliver the Lifestealer, explode, and actually get out before he's in real trouble. It's definitely a possibility here. But right now, just looking at the draft, I do have to say I favor Digital Chaos. I think Digital Chaos is looking really strong. They have a lot of potential. They don't rely purely on the Chronosphere. They don't land the Chronosphere. Timber's still going to be able to jump around. Ron is still going to be able to run around Star Surge when she gets Ogdoms. And with the Bloodlust, they're going to be so fast that I don't think they're really going to be under as much pressure as EHome. EHome's going to have kind of the pressure on them to be landing these giant Nyx Bombs, to land boats, things like that. So let's look at the predictions here. Total number of Blink Daggers purchased. I'm thinking maybe the Kunkka, maybe the Faceless Void, but that's going to be it. So I'm going to do 0-2 here. The Nyx actually quite possible, but still not enough to go 3-4. Player with the most kills. I'm going to have to go Weeha on this one. Mirana definitely has solo kill potential, also going to be in a lot of team fights. Number of Roshan kills. I don't think this one's going to go too late. Actually, with a Death Prophet, though, I'm going to say 3. And then most runes picked up. I was right with EHome in the first game, but I think Mirana is just so good at getting runes that I'm going to have to go Digital Chaos for this one. So predictions are made. Last time I was 4-for-4 on my predictions, so let's see if I can pull it off again. And look at this. This Nyx here does have the that Ti, what is that, Ti3, Ti2, Assassin's Dagger. That's a nice little pickup there for him. Ice on the Nyx, heading towards top. He is going to be up against the Solar Resolution, so their position, general position one, is going to be playing in the offlane. And Mu, an absolute wrecking ball with this Timbersaw, is going to be playing in the safe lane. Resolution will give the... Let's see if they give it to Old Chicken, probably on the Death Prophet there. And Old 11 does try to snag that. Oh, he's in a lot of trouble, actually. Weeha doesn't have his skill point made yet. He could go arrow, and he will go arrow. He's going to throw it out, and it's going to hit. That's going to be Old 11 hitting the deck. He's down. First blood going the way of DC. And not the start EHome obviously wants. But, man, that is rough. I mean, I think EHome needs to win the early game, so losing their position one and giving Weeha that early kill is going to be trouble. And looks like Skywrath going for this first. Oh my god, he gets the courier. This is a horrible start for EHome. Oh my goodness.
Hey there, can you hear me?
Yep. Alright, so this game I will be accompanied by my friend Kinky, my previous fellow co-caster when we did some events in the past. How are you doing?
Very previous.
Yeah, quite a while ago. I think we're both a little rusty when it comes to casting, but we'll...
I'm going to be playing the role of the guy who's asking all the questions. If somebody doesn't know what's going on, we're probably in the same boat. So I'll be asking the questions, and Catch a Cactus will be coming out with the answers as best he can.
Sounds good. Well, right now, things, you know, were pretty action-packed in the very beginning. A really rough start for EHome with that quarter kill and the first blood going the way of DC. But things have slowed down a little bit. They're getting some pulls in the top lane. They do have the stack going. But Misery sitting here just kind of absorbing a little bit of the experience. They can go on them, but they don't
have the disruption. Might be in a little bit of trouble now.
Yeah, they don't have disruption on the Shadow Demon, which is, you know, he was trying to get some harass with this Shadow Poison. So they don't have the kill potential that, you know, this combo generally does.
Well, is he going to get level 2 off this wave? Is that enough experience?
No, there's no way he will with Lanham there soaking as
just
well.
Just the creep camp? No.
Yeah, that small camp doesn't give too much. Even if he was solo, he might not get it. And with Lanham there, he definitely won't. So, all things considered, you know, I think EHome, they're still in a decent place. They do have to win the lanes. Lanham with a little bit of a cheeky fake torrent there. He does cancel. Resolution does pull the lane himself. He is getting open wounds, but he does have time walk. He should be able to get away. But as I say that, he gets disrupted. Uh-oh. Will the torrent connect in time? He does get lifted, and he actually just goes down.
Wow. One of the things I noticed when I came back to Dota 2 right away was the change that they made into Faceless Void. And I say come back, I should preface by saying that it had been a good 2 years since I had regularly played. And that change to his jump was huge. So it kind of confuses me why he didn't use it there.
Yeah, it's not long enough range for him to have gotten out of the disruption range of Shadow Demon, which is why he wanted to hold on to it. He was trying to get them to disrupt him early and hope that he could jump out before the torrent hit, but unable to, as it was just perfectly timed by EHome.
Yeah, that makes sense. It's actually one of the abilities that I've had the most trouble adapting to when laning against Faceless Void. It's always been seen as an escape, but it can be
the
wrong.
He gets the bash. He's
now
going on ice. Will he be able to get this kill? No, ice will salve and walk away. Very close.
Another bash probably would have done it.
Mm-hmm. Hold 11 in some trouble here. He's going to walk away. He doesn't have Spike Carapace up, but he does just kind of get out of there. We do have Ogre Magi going mid.
Yeah, he's been getting a lot of play this tournament, has he not? I mean, I know his kit pretty well. And he's a pretty popular support for the extra damage. But he's a little bit... Have they done anything to him to reduce the RNG factor?
Yeah, he is much less RNG than he used to be. He does overall get less of those, like, early 4x multicasts and things like that. But early game, he gets a lot of, like, 2x. A lot of 3x. Basically, each level in his multicast makes it so he's very likely to get that tier. So at level 1, he's pretty likely to get 2x. Oh, Fenrir in a lot of trouble here. They do have the arrow. They throw it out. It is going to whiff. I think Fenrir will get out of here. Just barely.
More interesting in the TP out.
Yeah, Deathrop picks up a kill down there on Moo. That's a huge kill. Keeping this Timbersaw down is going to be crucial to EHome.
Yeah, there's a lot going on. That courier kill in the beginning. You don't normally see that, do you?
It's been pretty prevalent this tournament. A lot of teams going for it. A lot of teams have been pretty good at countering it, but you just don't expect it from a Skywrath mage. I just think that they, you know, there wasn't a Ricky, there wasn't one of those heroes that you're like, okay, I gotta protect my courier. Hold 11,
yeah.
Ice Impale is gonna keep him alive. There was definitely some pressure there, but he, oh my god, Moo's still going for this. Torrent comes out from Lanham that will push them back, so just gonna reset a little bit. So let's quick look at the last hits here. If I can remember which button that is, W, okay. So Death Prophet sitting at 27, as well as the Nykes. We do have Timber and Faceless Void and Mirana following up that. So it's pretty, you know, it's pretty favoring DC, despite both of the highest going to EHome. But as I say that, Timber does catch up.
Yeah, how do you feel about their positions? I know you've probably talked about the draft a little bit. The Nyx solo bottom makes a lot of sense. They seem to be doing a lot of rotation, though. Where is the Nyx right now?
The Nyx is bottom right now. He's dewarding at the moment. What EHome's doing a lot more than they did in the first game. In the first game, Kunkka and Shadow Demon were just kind of sitting around, not really getting much out of the map, whereas they are an extremely good rotating support combo, so they should be kind of going all over the place. And,
here you go.
Yep, here we go. Moo might just go down again. The ult coming out from the Death Prophet is enough, and this Nyx actually showing that he is pretty capable of countering out that Timbersaw. And Soxa will get out just barely. Wow, he is quite lucky to be alive, in my opinion. One more of those bats hitting him would have been enough. Let's see if Weeha tries to make the heroic play right here. He does have an arcane rune, so he could get off two quick star surges. They're only 8.4 second cooldown right now.
Well, this is the type of aggression that they need. Would you describe EHome as an overly aggressive team early game, or do they like to go for your longer I don't know, do you get 60-minute games anymore?
Oh,
90-minute games?
You do get some. Not anywhere near as much as there used to be. But the last game went to... the last game was a pretty short one. I'm thinking of the Liquid Fnatic game that went pretty long. But, ooh, in a little bit of trouble here. Fenrir gets the disruption. See what they get off. Well, they get. They actually don't have silence, but the torrent comes out. And look at
that. Wow.
That is
and where
the potential.
Was Fenrir?
Fenrir was hiding in the trees. He took this little path right around here, came around. He went to the secret shop. I know you can't see my screen right now, but he came through the trees, came out around. That's a path they added in the last map update, which was about a year and a half ago or so. And that path kind of allows for these kind of wraparounds, whereas the Dire offlane used to be pretty hard to sneak up on anyone, but because of little paths like that to the trees, you can kind of find openings.
Well, clearly Moo's making a couple of mistakes. That creepway was beyond the secret shop. I mean, is that kind of a position in which you just say, after having gotten ganked, these number of heroes are not showing? Is that a pretty blatant mistake to go push that wave?
I think he just thought there's no way they're going to be pressuring me again. They're going to try to get, more out of the map, but really they're prioritizing Moo, which, does mean that Resolution's been getting a lot of farm. He's actually ahead of the Nykes in terms of net worth. But DC is getting another tower here, so Resolution doing really well for himself, and he could end up being a problem later on in the game.
Out of the heroes that you see, actually, I'm sorry, I'm going to hold on that. They're looking like they're going top in hopes to get ice.
Yeah, that arrow isn't going to connect, but it does get a little bit close. He is... Oh, this is going to be probably death. Nope, never mind. I thought there was going to be a little more aggression coming out, but...
Yeah, he started going back at the perfect time.
Mm-hmm, he really did.
Not too soon either. Had he gone any earlier, that arrow would have hit.
And here we got a Nyx bomb coming in the Nyx delivery tank. This is going to be potentially bad. It really depends on how they play this. They don't have any vision here to see him.
Yeah, and they do have Chronosphere up.
Yeah, but if they do get a nice pop here, they're going to have to lock down. There is the Chrono in time, so it just goes on Fenrir. This could be really bad for them, but a nice leap just in time.
Oh, no.
Unfortunate for them. Nyx goes down absolutely instantly. So just a horrible, really just bad luck, in all honesty. Bad timing for them to engage on that. The Impale lands on Weeha! Oh my god, that was an amazing Impale there. He does pay with his life, but an amazing Impale. It looks like Old Chicken's going to be punished here. He's going to go down, and that Soul Siphon almost keeps him up long enough for Resolution to go down. But we see, this is why Ogre's getting picked, right here. That Bloodlust was giving Resolution just enough move speed to really just be that much of a factor.
Yeah, he really is a good pick. Again, I don't have really any experience playing him, but he can get quite tanky late game too, so it becomes kind of an issue dealing with him before the fight even starts.
Well, here's the thing about Ogre. He starts at a whopping 8 armor. Like, that is stupid amount of armor. He just has this natural, insane amount of armor. On top of that, he has the highest base health regen in the game. So he can just walk up to you and club you in the face, and there's really not much you can do about it all throughout the lane phase. And that transitions well for him because of that high base armor. If he picks up a couple of bonus armor items and just kind of gets a little bit of health, he has an incredible strength gain too. So the hero's just naturally insanely tanky. Mystic Flare goes out. Old 11 just destroyed. No chance to spike Carapace there. It's going to result in his death.
Now, that multicast, I'm seeing the new animation above the head when you cast something. Is that telling you how much multicast that's actually occurring?
Well, that is actually an aesthetic item that they just added in this compendium.
Oh, that part of the legendary?
Yep, that is his immortal item. That you see it on his back, that spinning wheel on his back, that like roulette-style thing. It does add that animation, so.
Now, how does his multicast work exactly? Is it just double, triple, and quadruple the spell effect?
Yep, so basically it works on all of his abilities, and each one does something different. Bloodlust and Ignite will just have a chance of making it AoE. So Ignite will become an AoE around the target you throw it on. The Bloodlust will just affect multiple heroes, and the Multicast will just make your Fire Blast cast an additional amount of times in the same hero. So you do get those additional stuns, you also get the additional damage. And they do want to try to go on this. They have a Nyx Bomb ready in the Nyx, but Resolution's so big already. And he's just going to TP out, and this Nyx Bomb is not going to do anything.
Yeah, I mean, they're not doing too bad. We didn't really talk a whole lot about that last fight under the tier one top lane. That seemed really silly. The Nykes, I know when the Nykes comes out of a Nykes bomb, he gains a certain percentage of life. Am I wrong?
Only when he comes out of a creep. So he doesn't gain anything by coming out of the Nykes. And he was low HP going in. They were hoping to just immediately have him rage up and not really be much. There is a Morana ult coming out. Weeha going mid. Might catch out ult 11 here. The arrow hits right before the TP finishes. He's going to spike Carapace and try to get out. I think he'll make it. Really,
surprised that Morana didn't have any backup there.
Yeah, that's a little bit surprising, but the Impale was on cooldown, so that looked like it was going to be a kill. If that arrow was just a little bit further out and able to do a little bit more damage, it would have been just a little bit more likely to
get
the
kill. Yeah, or with an Augments. How far is Morana away from building something like that? It looks like she is going the Augments, correct, with the point booster?
Yeah, I mean, pretty much almost every game this entire tournament, it's been just a full-out rush on the Augments from Morana. There's really no reason not to. It's honestly maybe the best Augments in the game right now. And Mystic Flare won't connect on old 11, but he's still in a lot of trouble. They do drop another sentry, but he's just going to kind
of
waltz out. I don't think they're going to be able to
find
him anymore. But his Vendetta isn't long. He's going to go on the Timber here. He's going to try to get the Vendetta off. They do get the Silence, and the Impale will go down. Spike Carapace. Misery keeps fake casting, keeps pumping. Looks like the Nyx will finally go down, but Old Chicken in a little bit of trouble here. He does pop his Hood of Defiance. He's going to try to get out, and it looks like he will be all right. The rest of DC kind of back up. That is a favorable trade for EHome, as the Timber was
quite
a bit ahead of Nyx. Yeah, they really do. Oh, man. Nice defensive disruption from Fenrir. I think they will be able to make it out.
I'm surprised. I really do like the disruption combo with the ghosts. I think that's probably why they felt at least a little safe there. I mean, obviously, I'm not experienced enough to call that overconfident. It certainly looked like they were going to be in a lot of trouble. The arrow did land, the disruption came out, but then DC decided not to really engage. I think maybe they thought that they had a fourth.
Mm-hmm. What they knew was that Timber wasn't up. They knew that Chronosphere was on cooldown, and that Mystic Flare was not available. So they knew there wasn't really anything huge coming out, and it looks like Misery's just going to go down. Boat connects, and Lanham, he's absolutely huge right now. He has more net worth than the Timbersaw on this position for Kunkka right now. I mean, if there's any story of this game right now, it's Lanham.
Yeah, that's pretty crazy. They're kind of combo-centric a little bit. I mean, of all the people I hate playing against, Kunkka can be really...
Yeah,
certain heroes, they do have abilities that are hard to deal with, but once you know them well enough, you can play around them. Kunkka, I've always found, is very hard to play around.
He can be, especially when a Kunkka gets levels on you and he starts getting that really early multiple levels in X marks the spot, and he gets enough damage in that Tidebringer. And this build right here, if you look at Lanham's build, this is kind of the prototypical support Kunkka build. You go the Windlace and the Phase Boots for a ton of move speed, and then you just toggle that armlet on just to get that huge Tidebringer damage. And he just X marks the spot. Look at this. He's just going to walk up, and there's not much that Faceless can do about it. He's just going to get out, and, you know, you can just kind of rinse and repeat that in these team fights. And I think he might go for a Blink Dagger next. It's possible. He could go a Shadow Blade if he really wants to just kind of be able to more hard engage on these team fights. But if he wants to be that kind of annoyance, that like Mosquito constantly stabbing them to death in the neck, kind of bleed them dry long over time, he could pick up that Blink Dagger.
Yeah, that's the least enjoyable version to play against. Yeah. There was a smoke coming out of DC. They went into the jungle and didn't find anything for EHome. I think they either scouted it out. They're going to respond with the smoke of their own because I think they know exactly where they are.
Yeah, and Kunkka's still sitting bottom, but he does have a TP. This is kind of an interesting fight because Resolution... Oh, they get the Impale on Weeha. Weeha's just going to get shredded. Oh, man, that is not the kill that DC wanted them to get. Sox
not even able to get her off. Yeah, getting the ult off would have been helpful, at least for Soxa, but...
There goes Soxa. That's going to be two dead. And only four heroes committed. Lanham, though, is going to go down here unless he gets some absolutely amazing armlet toggles. As I say that, he does get off one really nice one. He's going to drop the Torrent. It won't connect, and yeah, that's going to be the death. Mood getting the kill. Feels like, you know, a classic 90s revenge movie right there. Mu coming up to Kunkka, being like, you know, you killed my father, prepare to die. Although his father was himself. Something like that.
Very emotional. You know, this is pretty back and forth, but I feel like... How can I say this? The space that one team gains is because of a good play, but the space that they're losing is all based on purely mistakes. I mean, Kunkka dying there, Kunkka didn't need to die.
Look at this Nyx. He sees that Weeha doesn't really have any immediate support. He might go for this kill. I don't think he can get it by himself, so he is just going to kind of try to gain vision here. He's not going to go for the kill. But he might get this courier. He's going to get it. Wow.
Oh, wow.
Nice scouting on his part. He kind of gauged Weeha. He entered the lane, saw if that Star Surge hit him. It didn't hit him, so that means no vision right there. So he knew he'd kind of go in, and he knew that if DC got vision of him in the jungle, Weeha would immediately react. So he's probably watching Weeha and seeing if Weeha would start heading in his direction. If he started doing that, he would probably just immediately TP out. But as long as he knows that Weeha is still just kind of sitting there farming the lane, he is pretty safe and just kind of, you know, gains some map control in the process.
Yeah, I think the timing of that courier pick is actually pretty important, too. They're getting to the point right now where people are starting to finish up items.
Yeah, and here's the thing about this game. I really favor DC because I felt like, you know, they have a lot more flexibility in their draft. They have the ability to kind of, you know, not land their combos and still be viable in the game. But I also didn't expect Lanham to have 6,000 net worth at 18 minutes. So it's, you know, like, this is kind of changing up the entire script for me. And I'm kind of favoring EHome right now because he's going to get items in this game. And he's going to be, this is like a four-core game almost. I mean, you could say that Nyx isn't maybe...
Yeah.
Nyx is probably playing the position four right now on old 11. That's maybe how they're kind of playing this, and he is considerably behind Kunkka. But if you look at it, Sox is only at 2K net worth, and the Shadow Demon and Nyx are, you know, both over 1,000 ahead of him. So
yeah, on both of these main carries, but the Nyx and the, oh, I'm sorry, the yeah, correct, the Nyx. I always mix those two up. They're both pretty close in farm. I mean, they're both at 8K, 8200, 8100 for the Baseless Void. So there really is no separation there.
Yeah, I think the big thing is that Weeha is a little bit behind, but that's not really a huge deal, as he is playing Mirana, and once you pick up your Ognims on Mirana, which he's only 700 away from, you can catch up really fast. That gives Mirana just insane amounts of farmability, flash farmability especially, and she can kind of just play catch up, whereas the Death Prophet can't really flash farm anywhere near as well. The Death Prophet can kind of split push pretty hard, do a lot of things, but here we go. Ice. Probably going to drop here unless he can get an infest. Nope. Too many bashes.
Now, did they use Chronosphere there?
They did. They did expend Chronosphere, so it's not up. And old 11's going to scout out. Not going to find anybody. Fenrir gets vision on resolution with that.
I'm surprised they didn't go upriver for that. I mean, going into the jungle, they lost a lot of... I mean, the Lifestealer was going to die. But I felt like they probably could have caught both of those two out had they just gone upriver.
I think they thought that resolution, he's kind of a greedy player. He might just sit there and actually farm the jungle right after getting the kill, and they could catch him doing that. That's probably what they were thinking. But unfortunately for them, you know, he played it safe. He ran it right back to his tower, expecting the rotations.
Yeah, yeah. So of the two carries, Faceless Void and Lifestealer, which of the two do you prefer to be on? Well, considering that they're both on the same net worth, relatively, if they both hit a certain, let's say, 20K net worth, which one do you prefer in that situation?
Well, Lifestealer is definitely the stronger late game carry, if he can hit people. That's the big if. Faceless Void can pop that chrono and just kind of shred people. So, and he also has the follow-up from his team a lot more. Ice is going to have a tough time really locking onto people. And Impale's coming out of Mirana. Weeha probably going to go down. Nice four-step coming out, but we'll get Exarchs into Torrent. We'll go down. Moo's coming in, trying to get some harass. He is going to TP out here and should make it. I don't think that Ulz was able to come out there from Old Chicken.
That was a pretty good pickup. They did lose the Kunkka, though.
Yeah, they did lose the Kunkka, but, you know, DC didn't really use anything to get it. They still have all of their alts up, so not really... They didn't really expel much to get that. Either did EHome, but I think they'll be pretty okay with that trade. They did kind of need to pick up some kills on Lanham, keep him in check, because he was kind of spiraling.
Oh, they're going to go on the Death Prophet.
Yeah, this might be a mistake. Defensive Disruption comes out, keeps him alive, but, oh, the shredding just continues. Timbersaw just... Oh, my goodness, he's... So strong.
Yeah, I really like the defensive disruption, especially in that situation where the Skywrath Mage all just pretty negated. But someone else going in to continue the fight, especially in this situation, I don't know how I feel about it.
Ice, ice, ice. What is he doing? He's completely isolated. The boat is coming. It's actually going to be a really nice boat. Lands on two. Misery gets popped up, but Ice, ice, ice in a lot of trouble. Defensive Disruption comes out, keeps him up for a little bit, but that's just giving Mu a perfect chance to Whirling Death right out of it. Lanham, he has the Time Diffusal, the Time Dispersion on himself, and he's going to be in a lot of trouble.
Arlo, this is a catastrophe.
Yeah, this is not looking good. The Chakram comes back, and that's four heroes down for EHome. DC just really taking command of this game.
Old 11, I'm not quite sure what Old 11 is trying to accomplish here. I don't think he's going to do anything, but if there were a ward down, and we know that that's a popular ward spot right there behind the Ogre Magi.
Yeah, he is going to try to probably get Misery here. He knows Chrono's on cooldown. It's still really risky. He's waiting for him to separate a little bit more. And, ooh, he's still thinking about it. Misery is HP, is regening quite hard, and he is going to probably back out here. He's under a lot of trouble. He's actually about to come down in a sentry. They're going to get vision of him. He could be in a lot of trouble here. Misery gets the fire blast, ignites him. He might make it out. He impales, but no, he actually pops the Vendetta. I think he could have gotten out. He could have just ran away.
Yeah. He lost his opportunity. He had an opportunity, and if you're really going to take that much risk, if you're really going to put his life at risk, there was a better opportunity to do that.
Mm-hmm. Oh my goodness, Mu coming in hard. Fenrir gets the Demonic Purge on him. He's going to be in a little bit of trouble, but he wools himself up. This is exactly why he picks up the wools, to avoid these type of combos. But Old Chicken pops the wools himself, but oh my god, a resolution with the amazing Chronosphere. Catches three, and just completely makes this almost an unwinnable team fight for EHome.
And the ghosts are popped defensively, and when that happens, all you gotta do is run away.
Yep, they get to and wait, expel Old Chicken's ultimate, and that's definitely a very big win for DC. Cause now,
what's the cooldown on that? 140 seconds?
Yeah, ghosts are very long cooldown. I think it's actually longer at level 2. I think it... Nope, 145.
Yeah, so they're just gonna wait for the ghosts to turn off and then just re-engage.
That's the big difference between DC and EHome. EHome can't really fight without their cooldowns up. But DC can. They, you know, their cooldowns are down. They're like, whatever. Timbersaw can still just go absolutely ham. He's got 19 charges on his Bloodstone, so he has plenty of mana to work with. Defensive Disruption comes out, and will keep the Nyx alive for a little bit. Nice Spike Caracase coming out. We'll keep him alive a little bit longer. Timber's in a little bit of trouble here. He might actually go down. He wools himself. We'll see if they can actually get the kill.
Yeah. Oh, did he suicide?
Yep. He popped his Bloodstone. Suicided. Rana? Playing a little bit cheeky here.
How many charges does that take away from your Bloodstone?
I think it takes out like a third of them, I do believe. So,
penalty is pretty high.
Mm-hmm. A third of its charges, yeah.
I mean, I actually think that went pretty decently underneath the tower for EHome.
Not
they
really,
seem
though.
To be falling apart in the last 5 minutes.
For EHome, I mean, it's actually only a it's only a 4K gold lead for DC. So at this point in the game, 4K gold is nothing. That's like one big team fight, one big killing spree going their way. So, you know, it's definitely a winnable game.
Oh, wow. The timing could not have been worse on that.
Yeah. EHome just kind of fallen into a few bad situations. But, you know, Nyx does have his Desolator. He does pick up a hand of Gloves of Haste, so I'm trying to think of what he's going to go for his next item. Could be a Maelstrom.
The Faceless Void. The Faceless Void, and then what we just saw where he dodged, he time walked and dodged the Nyx Bomb.
Mm-hmm.
Did he time walk there just purely out of chance? Just for the movement?
I do believe so. Or, yeah.
Do you feel like he knew what was going on? There was no way that he knew what was going on. There was no vision.
I actually didn't catch that. I was looking mid, but just knowing the positioning of where it happened, they didn't have any sentries there. The sentry was over here, and I don't think that was quite envisioned, so I don't think they saw the Nyx. I think he was just using his time walk to farm a little more efficiently in the jungle.
Oh, we got a smoke coming out of EHome. I think they're going to try and take a fight here mid.
They will, but DC has everything up, and they're all stacked. This could be really bad for them. Nyx bomb comes out, goes on Mu. The boat's not going to land. He ulls himself up. Here's going to be a chrono. It lands on two. It's only the support combo.
Another good range hit.
But there goes the Shadow Demon. No disruption available, so could be still pretty bad for EHome. And yeah, there goes the Nyx.
Yeah, with that Timber Smog coming back in.
Weehan a little bit of trouble, but he does pop the ultimate. They don't have any detection from the look of it, so he's just going to walk away. And Mu just picks up another kill. That's three heroes down. Ice pops the Rage. He's going to try to turn this around. But really no one to go on. He's just getting kited. And this is exactly what I was afraid of with the Nyx, was that he would just kind of be kited up and kept from ever really getting his right clicks off.
Oh, wow. And Death Prophet's just getting shredded.
Yep, that's a full team wipe. I think, you know, that was just a huge mistake on EHome's part. They they walked into their whole team without any vision of them and, you know, just let them engage on them. It's not like they have a huge ultimate where they can just CC the entire team and keep them from really getting off that massive chrono or anything like that.
Yeah, and it seems like they totally negated the use of any items. They did get an engagement on the Timbersaw, but then they boated, but they forgot about an Ooles, they forgot about a Force Staff, they forgot about all these items that could be used defensively to just change the positioning of the fight.
Alright, Misery in a little bit of trouble here. He does get purged up. Weehawk jumps out, gets a lot of damage on old 11. He now knows that he's under vision, taking that damage. The Torrent comes out, catches Weehawk, but there's just not enough damage coming out from them right now. They just walk out.
No, and the Chronosphere is up in 5 seconds.
Yeah. I think DC's going to be very happy just getting the Melee Racks. They'll back off, but I mean, it's really just this Faceless Void doesn't even need many items. He gets Bloodlusted up, and that's so much flat attack speed. 60 flat attack speed. That's like a Hyperstone and a half, I do believe. Hyperstone's, 55, so it's a little bit over a Hyperstone. But Hyperstone is 2,000 gold. So you're basically just giving him a buff that gives him over 2,000 gold worth of attack speed. On top of that, it gives him, what, like 15% move speed? 16% move speed on top of a Hyperstone's worth of attack speed. I mean, that's basically just giving someone like 3,000 net worth every time you cast it on him.
Yeah, it's pretty crazy. What do you think Old 11 is doing right here? Are they pinging for the Roche just because they feel like they need to get it to get back into the game? Or is he just scouting
it? He's scouting it. He wants to know if they're going to smoke in. I think they're expecting DC to kind of smoke in, press their advantage. And what he can do is just kind of sit here. As soon as he senses them coming, he'll just blink out, and at least they'll know. And they can kind of get heroes in the position to turn this around. Maybe they can get a giant ghost ship into an impale, into Nyx bomb with ghosts flying. I mean, they kind of need this miracle setup to win the game, and there's really no better place to get one off than the Roche bit.
Now, we've seen bigger comebacks, correct?
Oh yeah, definitely. Fnatic Liquid was a bigger comeback last game, for sure.
They are in some big trouble here, though. This is going to be a really difficult, and the more mistakes they make, I mean, DC just as a five group right now, I just don't think you can. And they're going to ult out the run ult. They're going to go take a fight because they know any fight that they can.
Old 11 seen this coming. Monstrous impale. They're going to get a huge boat off, too. This is insane. They're going to drop resolution. Resolution on the deck. Weeha might go down, too, here.
Misery down.
Yeah, that's two. Well, actually, Misery still Glimmer Capes out. They might only get resolution here. Mu in a lot of trouble. We'll see if he actually goes down. Lanham armlet toggles in. Mu suicides himself, and Ice still chasing down Misery. He gets the open wounds. Misery's going to turn, but there's the Rage, and he should just go down from one more right-click here. He's so fast, though. Oh, my God. Ice just has to turn around. Wow.
I can't believe he turned around.
me too. That's what I think makes the difference between us and a pro player, though, is that we would just chase him all the way to their fountain until we were dead.
Oh, I would have chased.
Yeah,
I would be going for a long time.
EHome needs to be careful here. They don't really have anything up. And Nyx kind of jumps in. Isn't going to catch anything. And unfortunately, they're not really going to get absolutely anything out of this this team fight. You know, this team fight was definitely huge for them. It kind of turns things around. But not being able to capitalize on it makes it just a little lackluster.
Yeah, I agree. I think it was probably an important fight for the sheer motivation of it, because at that point, you're kind of in the position where if you try and fight and lose another fight, you're probably going to lose the game just because nobody really feels like playing anymore. You just kind of lose the spirit of it. But having won that fight, they do feel now like they can maybe not take a fight, but at least defend appropriately.
And unfortunately, I don't really know what Lifestealer can do in this game. He's just getting kited so hard. He's going for the BKB that will kind of help with that, but I don't think it's enough. I think he really needs move speed. Unfortunately for him, he doesn't have an Ogre Magi to just be like, here you go. Maybe, you know, it sounds crazy, but I almost think SNY might be the pickup just to give him a little bit more ability to stick to his targets, at the very least an Echo Saver.
What does it look like he's building towards? Can you tell by what
he's
going
BKB right now? And I think, you know, it makes a lot of sense.
Well, it's strange though, no? Isn't that a strange item for him because he does have the Blood Rage?
Well, it's just basically saying, hey, I'm not going to get Mystic Flared. I'm not going to get, you know, Ogre Magi'd. And it's going to help out with the Mirana as well. No Star Surges. The Rage, they can just kite him through the Rage. It's going to be a lot harder for them to be like, all right, we're not going to engage you for a full, like, 15 seconds. You know, those are two very different things. Yeah. 6 seconds and 15 seconds. But at the same time, you know, they can always just back up and waste his BKB charges.
So EHome is going to try and take the Roche basically just at a positioning advantage, but DC know about it and they're coming right at him.
Yeah, they're from the top, they come in. Horse. But they do have vision of this. Old 11 and Chronosphere is not going to hit anyone. Man. That's really bad for DC. They can't really fight this right now. Nice Bomb comes out.
And a whiffed impale.
Yeah, Ulz will come out on Moo. It will keep him from getting boated. They're going to back up, go back into the pit.
Yeah, I think they got to back up. The Death Prophet, the Black King Bar is on cooldown right now.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, absolutely.
I think they're just having a hard time finding an exit.
I really think that this Death Prophet needs to pick a pipe. I've seen multiple hero or players doing this, and they're actually just going to give up the Roche. They got it low, and they just have to give it up. They can't take this fight anymore. And here I thought DC couldn't take the fight, but, you know, EHome just... They had Ghosts up for a little bit still. They could have maybe just gone right back into the pit and just said, hey, Chrono's down, you know, come at us. This is our best chance of actually taking a fight, but they don't. And they give up the Roche.
Yeah, that, and that's something that EHome needed.
Yeah, absolutely. But I really think Death Prophet needed to finish this pipe. Giving the supports a little bit of a magic resist, being able to pop that and just give him that bubble, that magic bubble, would keep the Shadow Demon alive. Because right now the Mirana just jumps in, gets the double Star Surge, and these supports just crumble. But giving them that extra little bit of magic resist will definitely help keep them alive. And they need these disruptions coming up from the Shadow Demon in the back line.
Yeah. I feel like they probably would have continued that fight had the Impale landed on the Timbersaw. I'm not very good at landing abilities. However, that Impale, I mean, he was right next to him. I don't know how you missed that.
Mm-hmm. Timbersaw is a pretty shifty guy. Pretty hard to hit, especially when he's bloodlusted up and has that additional move speed. I mean, look at this. This is a Timbersaw with 435 move speed. Our Lifesteal only has 360. He's so much faster than Lifestealer. How do you expect the Lifestealer ever to right-click these people down?
Oh, here you go. Blink in from Murano. She's just going to Starfall. Yeah. Well, what made Lifestealer such a popular pick in the last majors? He was either getting picked or banned out. And obviously, he's good, but I feel like there was a combination there that people were exploiting with another hero.
Well, it wasn't really a combination with another hero as much as it was the fact that he countered so many of the heroes that were popular. I mean, Axe is still a very popular pick, but he was a lot more popular back then. You saw a lot more Tide. Heroes like that who just kind of wanted to stand in the team fights and be kind of extremely hard to bring down. That's exactly where Lifestealer excels. Every time he hits someone, he takes out so much of their current max HP that, you know, no one can really just stand there and be like, fight me. But heroes that are great against it, heroes that are great against it are heroes that can't be bursted during CC and also can't be, you know, are very elusive. An example of that are Faceless Void, Timbersaw. So, not really good against either of those heroes. Which is why I was kind of surprised to see him pick it on the last pick.
Well, Pipe is down. They still look like they want to engage. arrow. They're trying to hit an arrow.
Yeah, it doesn't actually connect to anyone. There is the nice impale coming out, but
they're not gonna. Well, I think they know that Frodo on three. Go. Wow, huge Chrono Trigger.
Nice defensive disruption, but it's not enough. There goes Death Prophet. Instant buyback coming back. Old 11 in trouble, but Ice pops out of it. He's going for the Ogre Magi, though. That's not the target that they want to kill, even if he gets him. So what? And they're just going to kind of walk away. Aegis is still available for resolution, and they just walk away. Unbelievable. EHome.
And Ice doesn't do anything.
Yeah. EHome just reeling right now. Man. This is tough. I feel like this was just an extreme outcraft fight from DC.
Bob, and here they go on the Prophet. They feel like they can take her down. They still have the Aegis.
Yeah, that's a dieback. She's dead for so long. That's a GG. EHome out of the tournament.
Unbelievable.
And wow, I mean, I feel for Ice. This guy has been in the game for so long. He's been always so close. He's been on teams where you're just like, wow, you know. Is this their year? Is this their year? But never able to seal the deal.
Yeah, I feel like EHome is a better team than that. The other, not the casters, but the other, what do you call those?
Analysts?
People, talking heads on the tournament.
Analysts?
Yeah, the analysts. They're saying the same thing. I mean, and obviously they know a lot more about it than I do, but EHome just isn't playing very well.
I think that they just haven't been the same team since that game one loss to EG last night. They lost that game,
took it out of them.
And it's like they're a new team now. It's like they can't even draft. I mean, when you're at the brink of elimination in a tournament, the saying is always like, never get eliminated on your, or always get eliminated on your comfort heroes. Basically saying like, if you're going to get eliminated, do it on heroes that you feel comfortable with. Because you never want to get eliminated like this. You know what I mean? They just felt like they had no idea what they should be doing at certain portions of the game. And that doesn't happen when you're playing comfort heroes. When you're playing heroes that everybody knows, like your signature heroes, you're always going to know exactly where you're standing in the metagame. You're always going to be like, okay, you know, this is what I need to be doing. And so you rarely beat yourself. You let them, you know, you can get beaten, but you rarely beat yourself. And I feel like that's kind of what EHome did this game.
Well, where did the Lifestealer come in the draft? Was that one of their first picks, or was
nope,
that
it was
late pick?
Last pick.
So a last pick, you have to assume that they kind of knew the problems that they were going to encounter with picking Lifesteal up against the other team, Digital Chaos's draft. Did they have a solution for that already picked?
This is what I think. This is what I think. I think they thought, okay, what we're going to do is we're going to have this really nice Nyx Nykes bomb coming out. We're going to be able to get these squishy heroes like Weeha on the Mirana, maybe even getting resolution at times. The Skywrath Mage, all these heroes are going to be really easy targets for it. They thought they could get more of an advantage in the early to mid-game portion so that they wouldn't have to deal with kind of this like giant five-man push during the mid-game. But they did a decent job of that. They kept Mu down on the Timbersaw. But that's the thing. You know, you can't just keep a Timbersaw down for the early portions of the game. You have to keep keeping him down. And they didn't do that. You know, he caught up just fine. Once he found his footing.
Yeah, he really did.
It was tough. And they needed to keep Weeha down. Weeha is obviously an amazing Mirana. And letting an amazing Mirana just, you know, just go off is never going to work out for you.
Yeah, and the Faceless had pretty free farm as well. There was a little bit of action in the top lane, but they killed the Timbersaw three times consecutively. But it just seemed like they were going after the wrong lane. Because like you say, even after dying, you know, three times within 5 minutes, still able to pick up a Bloodstone and kind of go crazy.
Well, that's the thing. Faceless doesn't flash farm. He just doesn't. If he gets really far behind, he's never going to like suddenly catch up out of nowhere. But he can still get off Chronos. Like, you're not going to be able to stop a Faceless from Chronoing. So they felt, okay, we need to transition. You know, Faceless, he doesn't need farm to win this game. But he got so much farm that with the Ogre Magi, he was doing so much damage in those Chronos just by himself that they really couldn't even fight just the Faceless.
I suppose as kind of a closing note, from the games that we've seen, and there's still a lot more games to come, of all of the heroes, and you said the other day that most heroes, aside from Bloodseeker, have been picked. But of all the heroes that have been played, are people talking about any particular